We've got everybody here. We have Jean Brooks, Ashley Harris, and Eric McPherson for the subcommittee. Taylor and Tanya are here from planning, and we have Ben Pierce here from legal. Tonight we have a draft plan, which we have put out on the planning website for everybody to look at the draft that has been pulled together from our meeting last week. Committee members, you'll see that there are some yellow highlights throughout the draft. Those are things that Ben wanted us to look at and be sure of the wording before we move too far forward. So if anybody, I know you all have looked over, if anybody has any discussion about what they got, that would be a good starting point for us. Okay, so I guess we'll do kind of what we've been doing. We can go page by page. Page one is just the whereases for the introduction of the ordinance. We don't really need that to go over any detail anyway. Page two, you'll see that Ben has highlighted in the purpose section, section two of the ordinance. If everybody wants to read over that and see about the highlighted area and see if you have any comments or questions. Ben, if you had specific questions too.
Well, one thing we don't need have to have an answer to, but if anybody has any suggestions for a name for this ordinance, that is something that we probably need to think about.
Well, I thought it was called Solar Energy System. That not what we called it?
Well, that's just the name I picked. I went through lots of silly acronyms before I decided to be serious.
Well, that's fine with me.
I don't have a problem with it.
Me either.
Okay, well, the title of it is exactly what's inside of it, Ben. So it looks like down in the warehouses, we have an option as like a solar farm ordinance as well. Depends on how y'all want to title it.
No, those are just where I left it. The yellows are just kind of some questions that I had.
Okay.
And I can go back in and fix any of it. So y'all just let me know what you like, don't like, any of that.
Well, it sounds like we're good with the title. So that page two, section two, y'all want to read over the highlighted area. I'll just read it aloud. The Alamance County Commissioners hereby establish certain criteria relating to solar energy systems and their associated land uses. These uses, by their very nature, produce potentially objectionable levels of aesthetic impact, traffic, noise, light, and or other impacts upon the lands adjacent to them. So Ben, you were questioning that to make sure that we include everything in that statement that we're concerned about?
Right. I mean, this is a statement as to why we need a solar farm ordinance, so that if there's ever a question about what the goal, what this is trying to accomplish, we can say that we were trying to regulate things like aesthetic impact, traffic, noise. I don't really know how much noise there would be, but those kinds of factors, if there's anything that anybody wants to add, wants to take out, it seems like a small thing, but it could potentially be very important for us to say, have a good, strong statement about why we need this.
Ashley, you probably do a lot more of this than the rest of us. Is there anything you or anyone else finds in there?
I'm sorry, Tanya. There was a little bit of an echo when you were asking your question.
Oh, I'm sorry. I know you look at a lot of things like this on your job. Is there anything that jumps out at you or things you'd want to add?
No, I think when you say the associated land uses, I think that pretty much is it.
Yeah, Anybody else in the committee?
Can you hear me?
Yes, hello? We can hear you, Ashley.
Okay.
Anybody else fine in the committee? Okay. Eric, you good with this too?
Yeah, I'm fine with it.
All right, so we'll just check that off as the way we want it. All right. Page 3 is more definitions. If everybody's good with that, we can move on to page 4. That's where Ben looked like he had some more clarity that he needed. So Ben, the streams definition, that's straight from the heavy industrial development ordinance?
That is correct. That's the exact one copied over. And the solar energy system is, even though it's not in yellow, that's the exact definition from the template ordinance. But I did add the last sentence that doesn't apply to farm, residence, business, or other facility where sale of electricity produced is secondary to on-site consumption. Because I thought I had a note from last week that you didn't want it to apply to places where they were generating their own power.
Correct.
All right, so y'all are good with the definition of the solar farm or solar energy system and the language that being captured from last week's meeting, does that read the way y'all want it to?
It does.
Yes.
Okay. So the streams definition, that streams definition for the heavy industrial development ordinance was modified kind of late in the ordinance writing. So you all tell me if there's something you want to back off. I don't know that there's any more we can put in. I think it's pretty inclusive of a lot of things. So you kind of tell me what you would like that to say or read, if different than it is. So it's different than what you all looked at on planning board. This was adjusted once it got past y'all.
Do you remember why it was adjusted?
It was done at the commissioner level. It wasn't done by staff. So it was just an adjustment there.
I mean, I don't have a problem with it. That's the way the other one reads, correct?
Yes, that's directly out of HIDA.
I'd say just leave it like
that. It is fine, right.
Okay. So we go down to minimum lot size. No system should be situated on a track of less than 10 acres. That's something we've talked about quite a bit, and are we all good with that?
I am.
Yes.
Yes.
Ben, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that's what the HIDO says too, right?
It is. That's, I left it in there from the HIDO.
Awesome. All right, so we're moving down to the building height limits. You're going to see pretty much the same language from the HIDO in this. So if y'all want to take a look at that, I know you already have. Make sure you're comfortable with that.
Well, I just didn't know if y'all wanted to leave that in, even though solar farms are probably not going to have these things. So whether it made any sense to leave something in that's not going to be useful or whether you just prefer to take it out.
So Ben, where it says number one, or television towers or any equipment for the transmission of electricity, that's not included in these lines that they pull off the solar farms to transmit. You're talking about like the higher level utility lines?
This is the exact definition from the HIDO, and I didn't really read it or pay that much attention to it. So even though those would be excluded, they would still be under the regular building code. So I don't think that this is given the nature of solar farms, that this height limit is going to be a particular issue, but I didn't know how y'all felt.
I mean, most solar farms don't even have a building on them, do they?
I don't think, the ones I've seen don't usually have much of a building, if they have any.
Yeah, that's right.
I don't think we need the building height limit, do we? This whole section?
Let's say the reason that we put something in is if this industry changed any, our ordinance would cover something unforeseeable in the future.
But wouldn't it, would it apply though if it says used for human occupancy or intended for human occupancy? I would assume that that would just kind of knock it out.
Yeah, I mean, I'm okay with taking all of it out. I just, there's the better safe than sorry logic. And then there is the, we want to be inclusive logic. And then there's the fact that we don't want it to be too long and burdensome. So I didn't know which thought process carried the day. Is it better to be inclusive and long, or short and sweet?
I would say we could leave it out for this part.
I mean, I'm good with that. Just taking it out.
Okay. If y'all want to add it back in at any point.
Yeah, that's fine.
And if you want to add it back in, it's just a simple matter of cutting and pasting from the high dose. So the next section on the operation setback is something that I don't know if we want to go get back bogged down, because we spent a lot of time talking about this, and whether or not that's the best use of our time. But take a look and see if you like the way I worded the 75, the setback language, if you like the way that's worded or not. And like I said, I don't know that we have enough time to really get into everything right now.
You worded it just like what we talked about, looks like to me.
That's what I tried to do.
That's what it looks like.
I'm good with
okay,
it.
Okay, we'll just revisit that in a day or two and make sure y'all are still good with it. You don't have any other, because that's kind of the heart of this whole thing. And then the aviation stuff is basically cut and pasted directly out. I just didn't know about sending, whether we needed to leave in here that you had to send it to the commander's council, or whether that was something else that could just be cut. It's not terribly relevant to us.
Could you cut out the irrelevant parts and just say contact planning for requirements?
Yeah, I think that's probably a good idea. Or say that planning will maintain a list of people who need to contact or something, and we'll just put the FAA or something on that. moving down. Another one is this. We didn't really talk about it much at the last meeting, but other than my misspelling and operations, do we want to allow solar farms in the flood hazard area or wetlands or swamps or Wildlife Commission habitat? Now, this is directly from the HIDO, and we don't allow these things in the HIDO, but I don't know if we have the same harms in allowing solar farms in areas that you can't build other stuff in.
Could that be left up to the Soil and Water Board?
That would add complexity to this if they had to get a sign off from Soil and Water. But I don't really know enough about their processes to be able to say, but I can certainly look into that.
Well, I mean, sometimes what they call a wetland, you know, is not that the situations I've ran into before is, you know, what the definition of a wetland is sometimes gets sort of vague, you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
You wouldn't want to hold somebody up from a project over something like that. That's what I mean. I think if there was a way we could do it on a site-by-site analysis, I know that, like you said, that puts more into it, but, you know, it would probably be better for the landowner.
Yeah, I mean, let me look into that, and I'll get you some language or something in the next draft.
I mean, if not to the Soil and Water, couldn't they just, can we put in there that it's a no and they could appeal it to the planning board?
Well, then the planning board is going to have to get into figuring out what is a wetland and what isn't. And that is a very complicated area where the Army Corps of Engineers will certainly have an opinion. And many people may disagree with the Corps of Engineers' opinion. And we don't need to get in a battle between the landowner and the Corps of Engineers, because we're going to lose that one. So let me just work on that. If you want some, do you want me to have some language dealing with flood, wetlands, and wildlife, or do you just want to say, we don't need to worry about solar farms in those areas?
I mean, really, can you even build one in a wetlands? Because don't the electrical run through the conduit in the ground? You wouldn't want to put that in the water, would you? Or does it make a difference?
Well, that goes back to what the Army Corps of Engineers says is wetlands.
What they define as a wetlands, I mean, is a whole lot broader sometimes than what me and you would call a wetland.
But if we allow it in there, is the Corps going to jump in and try to stop it if they've classified it as a wetland?
Well, yeah, I mean, and they may... I don't. That's where I don't know enough about what their rules are. But I know that they have lots of rules. And so it's a question of, do we want to try to have additional rules on top of the Army's rules or the Corps of Engineers rules? Or do we want to just say, if it's fine by them, it's fine by us?
But the question is, if they say no, can we can't overrule them, can we?
No, if they say no, then the designers are going to have to figure out a way to do it. But if they say yes, do we want to say no?
No.
Okay. Well, let me work on this language then, and we'll take a look at this next week, or whenever planning board or whenever people take a look at it, y'all can make a special note to pay attention to whatever gets decided. Scrolling down, the rest of these are pretty much straight out of the HIDO.
Yes, let's look at those stream setbacks, because as we define streams is different than how we wrote up the setbacks in the HIDO. It talks about perennial and intermittent streams, where the definition actually gets much broader than that. So it's a little bit of a conflict in language.
Okay. Well, let me fix that then.
That would be great. But the 50-foot is standard from about anything in the state. So are y'all still good with the 50-foot? I know we talked a little bit about this last time.
Yeah, that's fine.
I'm good with it, yeah.
Me too.
And then we didn't really talk about it, but posting the bond for the landscaping and screening, that's all straight out of it. The gating and fencing is straight out of the HIDO. I left the lighting language in from the HIDO because that is, applicants are encouraged. They're not really required to do it. And we do have we put that in the HIDO because of the three county observatory? Or three college observatory down there. So the compliance with other governmental requirements is straight out of the HIDO. Decommissioning is straight out of the model ordinance. And then I think all of the grandfathering is directly out of the HIDO. The main one and the area to talk about today is that Article 4, starting on, I guess, page 8, and the permitting procedures. We had a lot of those in the HIDO, and I wasn't really clear what y'all were thinking for the permitting procedures for the solar farms.
And we discussed this public hearing thing. What did we decide? Leave it in or take it out?
Well, that was what. Okay.
Go ahead, Ben. Sorry.
I was going to say I had lots of notes on discussions. I just didn't have an answer. I didn't know what y'all decided. So, I mean, do you want to have the type of public hearing or some kind of notification process that in the previous HIDO, we didn't have anything like that. Adding these types of public hearings was the main focus of the HIDO revision. So what do y'all think about requiring one, yes or no?
I think the public notice aspect is going to be important, just given our last, like I said, the last situation. We have to have something.
I mean, I'm fine with it either way.
Okay. So then having the notice, do you probably the mailing to the adjacent property owners is probably a good idea?
Mm-hmm. I'd say do the mailing to the adjacent property owners and don't have a public hearing.
Well, you generally want to have some way for people to complain. And if they're just getting a letter and the letter doesn't tell them what to do, then they'll figure out their own ways to complain. So I think if you're going to send letters, you need to have a hearing. Does anybody have an opinion about whether or not, other than sending letters, and I would suggest posting a sign on the property. You know, this one has newspapers, it has press releases, it has all kinds of stuff in there. How do y'all feel about newspaper ads for solar farms?
No, that's antiquated. Is it possible to say that that'll be posted to the planning board website or something like that?
We can.
Something that's less paper driven, because people aren't even subscribing to the news anymore. Paper newspapers.
No. If we're gonna post it, is the 10-day notice, is that sufficient? That's what the statute requires, 10 days before the hearing. Is that sufficient, or do y'all want more or less?
Is it 10 business days or 10?
It's 10 days. Yep, not less than 10, nor more than 25. So you have to have it around the time of the hearing.
I mean, I would think just leave it like it is in the high to be consistent. So you don't have one thing that says one thing and one thing says something else.
That's fine.
I agree.
Now, do you want it certified or regular? If you're going to mail notice to people, you want them sent to the adjacent property owners. You want them, well, I should say, do you want adjacent, just adjacent, which would mean just touching, or across the street, or do you want it to everybody within a certain distance?
No, just the adjacent ones, I'd say.
I agree.
Okay, so now we're on to certified or regular mail for the letters that go to those people.
I think you'd have to do certified just so they say they got it.
Right.
I agree.
Well, as someone who sends a lot of certified mail, good news never comes by certified mail. So lots of people will not pick it up. But it does have proof, at least, that you sent it.
You tried.
Yeah, you tried.
Yep. Now, do you want owners or residents or both?
Owners.
If it's a rental property, owners. Do you care if the owners. Tenant, just the owner?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. I think that's pretty much got the questions for that. And then I guess thinking more broadly, we have an intent to construct permit, and then we have the operations permit. Does the subcommittee have an opinion about whether we have two permits or one permit, or, you know, you come in and you get a sign off and then we check it, have a preliminary or a final? I mean, how involved in the permit process do you want the planning department to be?
It's only two permits, right?
In the HIDO, yes. In the HIDO, we make you do the intent to construct, and then we go out and we check that you build it the way that you said you were going to build it. And then we make you renew the operations permit. Now, these solar farm projects are probably going to be a lot less complicated than some of the heavy industrial type permits that we have. And we did the two separate processes through that to try and have more control over it, over the project while it was being built and the plans and things that were submitted. I don't know that that risk really exists with solar farms, which just don't have the harms that some of those other things do.
So when
can you go to one permit?
Yeah, we can do it however y'all want it. I mean, this is the part that we get to really customize. This is about workflow for the county.
I'd say do one permit.
And when do you want? I guess that something has to come in at the beginning.
Right.
But when do you want them to have site plans and all of that? Do you want them to have the site plans for the public hearing? Or is the public hearing just about, hey, we're going to build a solar farm?
Now, I think you would want the site plan at the public hearing, because that way they could see what it looks like.
If you got to have a public hearing, yeah, I'd say that's what you need to do.
Okay.
I would agree with that.
Now, after your public hearing, do you want the planning director to just sign off on the permit? Or do you want it to go to the planning board for a vote, or the commissioners for a vote? Or is the public hearing just kind of a chance for everybody to get on the same page?
If it met the requirements, it was just a rubber stamp in the public hearing anyway.
I'm sorry, you broke up when you said that. I couldn't make out.
I'm sorry. I was thinking that the public hearing, if they came in and met all the standards and then they had a public hearing, no matter what came out of the public hearing, if it met the standards, it got approved. Is that not right?
That's correct. That's correct, yes.
Okay, so why would we need it to come to the planning board to vote on it, or the county commissioners to vote on it, if it already meets it?
That's what the HIDO says. I'm just asking the questions.
I mean, I think once it comes in, if it meets the standards, then they can build it.
agree.
Mm-hmm. Okay, works for me. Tanya, any thoughts on from?
Well, I think we probably got both pieces here. If we're taking to a public hearing, we do what the old HIDO was missing. We let the public and give the public knowledge and notice. But hey, there's a project coming in. What, and it sounds like we're not wanting to vote, so we simply just set up a public hearing for information purposes, I guess at the commissioner level, going through planning board first to look at the project with the site plan. And then as long as, and I'm not going to submit the site plan and all those things to the board until it meets our requirements, and that's in the old HIDO language too, or the HIDO language we're using. So we certify that, yes, we believe it meets everything. We take it to a public hearing, and then we move on, we write the permit. Sounds like, is that the process y'all are looking for?
Because I mean, we can't, if it says, if it comes in and meets all the requirements, if it comes to the planning board and we say, no, we don't want them to build it, legally we can't do that, can we? I mean, why would you need to come to the planning board for a vote if it already meets the requirements?
Well, what the planning board would be doing, the planning board would be agreeing with the planning director.
Okay.
That, yes, this, the planning director has said this is preliminarily approved. And then you would be going back and checking that all the boxes were, in fact, correctly checked. And that nothing new came out at the public hearing that causes you to rethink the checkbox that you gave this project. And then if after the hearing you are still in agreement that it needs to be issued, then it gets issued. And if you say no, somebody came in and raised some point that wasn't considered, and that causes you to think, hey, this isn't correct, then you would send it back for that person to redo that part, or the planning director. There was a lot of accusations that the planning department, under the original, when the quarry got done, a lot of accusations leveled against the planning director that there was some kind of shenanigans going on. And this process was designed to stop those accusations.
I mean, I can understand that for stuff in HIDO, but do we even need that for a solar farm? I mean, I thought that was one reason we were trying to pull it out, because it didn't have all the problems and concerns that other stuff in HIDO had. I thought we were going to make it almost simpler.
So that's something to consider. I will say that we've had one particular solar farm that an adjacent neighbor has been to the commissioner specifically, and I believe the planning board a couple times, concerned about how it got through the process and how certain governmental agencies beyond the county did or did not get involved. So I think that's probably part of what we're looking at after hearing something. Like I said, it's one project, one person, but we've heard from that a little bit too. So this is all for y'all to write and do how you feel like it needs to be taken care of. Ben and I are just throwing things at you to make you aware, and then you can make decisions based off that.
I think they meet the standards for a solar farm. Go ahead and approve it. I mean, it's pretty cut and dry. They meet the setbacks. They stay away from streams, stay away from historical properties. You can pretty much put it wherever you want to, as long as it's more than 10 acres. I mean, that's kind of my feeling.
I agree with you.
Okay, then it sounds like y'all are thinking this public hearing is more informational. We, instead of calling it a public hearing, we should call it an informational hearing.
That works.
I think that works, yeah. But is there a way to kind of put a contingency in there if something, should something come up? I know we talked last week about, you know, not giving a lot of power to the planning director and things like that. So I just want to make sure there's kind of like a balance to some extent, but just making sure that if something does come up, the ability to change exists in the language.
Yeah, I mean, we can look, I'll look into that and think about that idea as to how we can structure this to bring a little more balance to it. Tanya, do you have any thoughts on additional permitting processes, things we need to think about?
Not really. I mean, once, typically if you just had somebody with a zoning situation rezone what would be a straight rezoning that automatically allowed these things as long as the site plan met it, a board would approve it, staff would give a zoning permit to them, and off they go to get building permits, and the building side checks to make sure when the final product is done, the landscaping and everything's in, and they give it power and it's turned on. So since we don't have zoning, that idea would be it goes before a board to say, like we were doing with Hydo, everybody looks good, just so the public gets to be aware of the process. And then we issue, whether we call it construction intent, whatever we want to call that permit, or just solar system permit, and let them go. And of course, building's going to look at it when they build it. And if something landscaping wise dies or is there some other issue, rest assured somebody in the community is going to let us know that. And then there's back to the renewal of that permit. We talked a little bit about that. I think we decided every 2 years, that's further down, but where we go out and visit on a regular but spaced out basis anyway to check the sites.
Okay.
I guess as well as considering a name for the ordinance, we have to consider a name for said permit, because we have this intent to construct in the authorization permit. Do we want them to be, or do we want to name it something similar or off on its own?
I mean, my thought would be that we don't call it the same as the Hydo. That way we don't have to worry about confusing, even though it adds complexity. That way we know every intent to construct is a Hydo. So let me think about that name and we'll have something to you on that. I think the rest of this, unless y'all have comments, is pretty standard about the administration, enforcement, and how it would work if you violate it. Does anybody have any thoughts, or just go with the way the county normally does it?
Go with the way the county does it.
Yeah, I'd say go with the way the county does it.
And then I did the Hydo has a spacing waiver in it. That's under Article 8. I took out the spacing waiver simply because this is all on that same property, and you don't have to worry about how close you are to your neighbors or anything like that. If you had a problem with your particular piece of property such that you couldn't meet that 75-foot that we're putting in place, you could apply for the variance. And that standard is on there about how it's extraordinary conditions and it's not, you didn't create it, and that it's going to not deter from the ordinance and all of that stuff. That's pretty much straight out of state law. But if you wanted to consider something else or something different, we could try to work with that.
So Ben, this is suggesting you could ask for a variance on any of the requirements of the ordinance?
Let me look at it.
Because that's definitely something we need to consider, of what we would allow people to ask for forgiveness on and what things we just don't want forgiveness on. Is it acreage? Is it setbacks? Is it landscaping? You know, what would the committee feel comfortable in letting people ask the boards to relook at and change for them?
Yeah, it just says that you get for cases involving practical difficulties or unnecessary hardships. Yeah, this is basically any kind of hardship or difficulty relating to the land that you're trying to build your solar farm on. Is there specific things we want to limit it to?
I mean, the only thing I could think of would be acreage. You know, if somebody wants to put one on something smaller than 10 acres or whatever, I think you need your setback and your buffer and everything.
Well, this, like, a good example might be if we require to have somebody to have a 75-foot setback, but their property runs right up against a cliff. I don't know that there's any place in the county that would meet that, but if there was, or the fencing requirements or something, that you've got a really steep cliff and it doesn't make any sense for you to run a fence down a vertical drop. That would be the kind of thing here that you would say, hey, maybe we're going to not allow you to run your fence down this cliff, or maybe we'll give you 50 feet instead of 75 because the terrain is such that nobody's going to be able to get close to it anyway.
Mm.
Do we still want people to say, nope, 75 means 75, which is perfectly acceptable? Or do we say, you know, maybe we can work with you if there's something really funky about your particular piece of land?
I mean, if we give them a variance, they got to come before the planning board and make their case, and we can say yes or no then, correct?
Yeah, I mean, this would actually be the commissioners. This is the quasi-judicial hearings that, until we get an ordinance that says otherwise, can only be done by the commissioners. But yes, they still have to make their case. They still have to show that there is something particular about this piece of land that causes a unique hardship, and it's not their fault. And just because I don't have the money to do it, or it's going to take too long, those aren't grounds for it. Something's going on here that it's just not going to be feasible for me to do my solar farm
unless you let me change the rules. But we don't have to let that for everything. We can say 75 feet means 75 feet. We don't care.
I mean, if it's going to the county commissioners for them to decide, I'd say leave it like it is and let them sort it out.
So that's going to include that historic property setback as well. They could ask for a deviation, like I said, on anything in the ordinance. And like Ben said, there's plenty of situations where they get really quirky and every piece of the ordinance doesn't fit the property. And that's what these kind of things are written for.
Well, if nobody has a thought on that, let me get this written up. I think that pretty much gets us through everything, doesn't it, Tanya?
I think so. The appendices are just examples of public hearing and landscaping thing and site plan review. Those are just kind of things and guidelines more than anything else, not through rules and ordinance related.
Yeah, and the ones that are standard to this are straight out of the model ordinance or from the HIDO in the case of the planting and spacing.
You're saying the 75 feet, it would go to the county commissioners if it was, is that right?
If somebody said, hey, my property, I'm trying to think of a situation that would matter. Or let's say we said you can't have anything but vegetative buffers in your 75 feet. And somebody comes up and says, hey, there's this railroad track that runs down the side of my property. So I can't put vegetative buffers in there. Can I count the railroad as part of my 75 feet?
Then you just need that to go to before the county commissioners, right?
Then you would have to go to the county commissioners, who would say, yes, the intent of this ordinance is to buffer the solar farm from other development. The railroad track does that anyway. And if you live next to the railroad tracks, a solar farm may not be as objectionable on the other side of it,
right,
as if you had one right up next to Elon College.
I agree with that. I mean, I don't see anything wrong with them going to the commissioners for that. That's what they wanted to do.
Well, I think that the question is, do we want to put a limit on it and say, can you ask or anything to be changed, or are there some things that you feel so strongly about that you don't want there to be any latitude in?
Yeah, I don't have anything, because it's only going to be a unique case anyway. Because you don't want to say, hey, you got to have 75 feet, or say you got to have a fence. And like you said, you got a mountain behind you. Anyway, I'm good.
Well, then I guess that pretty much gets us to the end. I just recognize I need to fix the, I didn't take out the language, the HIDO and the Appendix A, but I'll fix that.
All right, so for this point, since we ran over the draft a little bit, the question is, you know, we have a planning board meeting scheduled for June 11th. Is it the subcommittee's wish to put this on for the planning board to get a glimpse of what's going on? Mind you, I do have it online and all that, but do you all want to take it to the planning board at least to get a glimpse of it, to get any feedback? Because we're not in final draft, and we did, I think twice we did that during the rewrite of the HIDO, which was a bit more complicated. So that's kind of the discussion we lead to from here.
Would this be after the change, the things we talked about today, including what we talked about today?
Yeah, I mean, I can come up with a draft and have that done by the end of the week, that includes the changes that we talked about today. Well, assuming that things don't blow up any more than they already have in northern parts of the county, then I should be able to get that done.
I mean, yeah, I'm good with them giving a look and get their opinion. If anything, you know, hits them hard that they want to add or change.
I agree with that.
The way we handled this last time is we kind of had a representative of the subcommittee group lead them through, and we can provide electronic documentation with the agenda, but lead through kind of the thoughts, the big ideas, the highlights. Because like I said, we're not in final draft, but get the information to them, and we don't put it on the agenda as a voting item because we're not in final form, but just the information and see how it goes. So if we do want to move forward with just informational purposes, we need a representative of the group. Gene, as the vice chair, would that be an interest for you?
I'll do it. That's no problem.
Okay.
I'm just going to let everybody else volunteer first.
Well, I was going to take nominations next. So. All right. So with this being said, committee needs to kind of think about when you want to get back together to kind of finish massaging everything to get it to a final draft. And what looks good to you all?
Would it be best to meet the Wednesday right after planning board or right after the planning board meeting so we have it fresh with their commentary and we can go ahead and get it knocked out?
So that would be the 17th. Everybody wants to look at their calendar, see if that works for you.
I didn't know. Do we want to meet before, after Dan does this, before the planning board meeting?
Yeah, aren't you going to present it at the planning board?
I think we're just going to give them the highlights.
Yeah, we'll kind of give them a glimpse of what we've been writing on and see if everybody really hates it or really loves it. So you don't want to work too far without the rest of the board seeing what's going on. Yeah, it's up to the committee on when y'all would want to meet again. To send out the agenda for that meeting, I will have to get that out on the 5th. So that's next Friday, to get everybody's agendas out for planning board.
I didn't know if we wanted to meet before then just to review what the changes that Ben makes before. Because we can look at it on that Wednesday and still give them something on that Thursday, correct? Like next Wednesday and then the following Thursday give them whatever.
Yeah, we can do that. It's kind of, you know, if we do some more drafts, Ben will have to have time to update a draft. It's totally up to the committee on what they have time for, or what they feel like they need. Ashley or Eric, do y'all feel pushed either way?
Just do the 5th. If that works for everybody.
I'm sorry, what day was that?
You mean like the 3rd, Eric?
No, I'm sorry. Yeah, I said the 5th, the 3rd. That's right. The Wednesday. So we would be meeting on the 11th on the Thursday, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Ashley, does that work for you as well?
Yes, that's fine.
Scott, are you good with that?
I can do that.
What time do you all want to meet then?
Works.
Let's see, if the planning board hates it on the 17th,
11th,
the 11th, I'm sorry, can't we get together after the meeting and schedule another meeting among ourselves to go over the changes that they want?
We're going to need to do that because there's always some kind of input that we would want to include. But are we looking at the 17th for that follow-up meeting for just a subcommittee?
That would work for me if we could do go ahead and figure out when both, you know, do one before and one after and have them set.
Okay.
That works with everybody.
That works.
Both work for me.
Same time at 5:30 on the 17th?
That's good.
All right, so we've kind of covered the agenda items, unless there's something somebody needs to talk about from the committee. Okay, nope. Well then I guess we will see everybody back next Wednesday, and Ben's going to work hard to get us a draft out, and we'll go from there. I'll send everything out to you in probably this same format.
Okay. Sounds good.
Thank you.
Thank you.